so far we have been hearing about how to control, how to apply policies, how to define how your network should behave. In-situ OAM is about getting a very granular picture of how your network is behaving, so that that can feed back into your analytics platforms or your into your controllers, and you can draw insight from the data and then define how your network should behave in real time. And you can change your network behavior in dynamic way. It's not really restricted to just software-defined networking. You can use this the tools that are going to be developed, protocol extensions that are going to be done with In-situ OAM in general network monitoring. As you see, there are a bunch of people involved in defining this work at IETF. There are hardware software vendors. There are network operators from enterprise service provider as well as large data centers who are interested in this work and are defining it actively. You also see a lot of drafts listed out there. The data draft, which is defining what kind of data that is collected in In-situ OAM, is adopted and is a part of the IPPM work group. The other drafts, which will be on, that defines what to collect. The next part is how to collect that data, how to the encapsulation and the transport of that data. That is being defined. We have, again, a series of drafts to define it in various protocols, both overlay protocols as well as traditional V6 and V4 protocol. What we don't have yet is how to export the data that is collected and feed back into platforms like Vinod just described for analyzing and drawing insights and actually making use of that data. We have some work that was done as part of the LIME work group to define the model on how to enable and control what data should be collected. Otherwise, there is still a scope for work for modeling, controlling In-situ OAM itself. So what I'll do is I'll give you a very quick overview of what In-situ OAM is, what motivated us to define it, and then I'll talk about the journey through IETF, what is done in the IETF so far, and what we plan to do in the coming IETFs. So if you think of OAM in packet network, broadly you can do it in two ways. One, out of band, which is similar to if you take the analogy of real life. There are police cars standing with laser guns to monitor how the cars are being driven, how the vehicles are being driven on the road. That's the traditional probe way of defining collecting and monitoring the traffic. And that's what we do with ping, traceroute, and other tools that exist today, including Ethernet CFM. The other way is, of course, to collect, install devices in the vehicles, which collect data about how the vehicle is being driven, issues it faces while driving through the network. That has been attempted in the past, and that's what In-situ OAM is also focusing on. That said, In-situ OAM tools and extensions that are developed in In-situ OAM doesn't rule out its usage in the traditional probe means for collecting additional data and getting correlated information out of this monitoring. So what was the motivation? I work for Cisco, and while we and this work is being led by Frank Brockner, who's been with Cisco for a long time. And when we had been talking to customers, one of the major issues they were facing is when there are large number of ECMP networks, especially in the data centers, it was hard to monitor and troubleshoot issues when certain applications or generally, monitoring a large number of ECMP network was hard, so they wanted to have a way where we could give them something better than ping and traceroute, which can crawl and figure out what multiple paths in the network are being taken by certain flows and how they are behaving at any moment. That was a major motivation to start this in-situ or in-band OAM work within Cisco. The next was, at the same time, a few years back when we started this, NFV and NFV was trending, or it's still trending. So one other requirement that we were constantly hearing about is, in the traditional hardware-defined network functions, it was easy to, when you deploy firewalls and DPIs, it was easy to know that packet was indeed making through it because it was hardwired to go through these devices. Now with software-defined network or virtualized network functions, how do you make sure that when you have policies that make the packet go through firewalls, DPI, and other policy servers, how do you make sure that they're indeed going through that? So something in the packet should prove that the packet indeed made through all the devices, all the functions that it was supposed to make. So that was another use case. We were generally struggling with how to derive the traffic metrics, because correlating the traffic when it enters your domain and when it leaves your domain against the flows was not very simple. It was all done based on sampling, and at best it was giving you a very blur picture of what is going on. So we wanted to define a very granular, high definition, high resolution picture of the network and give operators a chance to use that very granular data to feedback control their network. So essentially, based on these some of the use cases which you saw now, there are a bunch of classes of metadata that you can collect for tracing the path, that is to figure out what path a particular packet, actual data packet in your network took. We need information like node and interfaces that packet traced. So that's one set of metadata that we can collect, which could be used for tracing and particularly useful when there are multiple paths between source and dest. The next part, which I mentioned about the proving that the packet is indeed making through a bunch of virtual functions or real functions, is to build some kind of proof of transit inside the packet. So that to collect and do that proof of work, collect that metadata inside the packet, is one other class of information we want to collect. Then, of course, if you want to figure out if there were packet drops, it's not really just TCP. There are all sorts of other transports that you would use. Then you'd want to collect information about whether if there were packet loss, there was packet reordering. So that is within your domain. So there are sequence numbers you could insert into the packet when the packet enters the domain and analyze the sequence numbers to see what happened. And there could be other custom metadata. For example, if it is a IoT network, you would want to know the geographic location of the nodes that the packet traversed, or the maybe even the battery usage levels if the nodes that the packet is traversing is a battery-operated device. You would want to know the status of the device. There could be even just generally when the packet was switched or forwarded by a node, you would want to know what is the CPU and other statistics of the get a snapshot of the data that of the node that forwarded or processed the packet. So these are some of the classes of metadata that are interesting to collect. So in a nutshell, this is what we collect, and what happens is all this kind of metadata can be inserted. We don't really recommend doing it in the general internet, but when an operator wants to do this in a domain, you define what data is to be collected, define what kind of transports that data has to be collected for. If it is a pure V6 network, you might want to collect it in a hop-by-hop extension header as options. If it is overlay protocols like VXLAN GP or NSH or GenEV, you collect it appropriately. You define at the entry of your network how to patch that additional metadata and what metadata to be collected. And rest of the transit nodes within your domain would abide by what has been told to do and what it has been told to do, and it would insert its own data as it forwards the packet. And at the egress, that data is removed, and then you can do all sorts of analysis and feed it back, store it, do whatever you would like to do with that data. So this is how it works. The packet enters the domain. Configure the entry points in your network to say what data for what flow you would want to collect. Accordingly, it will insert the additional metadata into the packet. As you see here, we are collecting trace information and the link information. So the node A inserted its node ID, which is A, and the link it is going to forward the packet on, which is 1. And then node C inserted its information, and so on. So you got the complete trace when it is about to leave the domain. You got the complete trace of how the packet, which path in the domain the packet traversed. You could get the ingress egress interface information as well. And the other part would be if you want to know whether it took, you want to have a irrefutable proof of work to say that the packet had to go through ACD and it did go through ACD. That is where we have something called service chain verification. There is a draft out there. It's a bit involved. It is based on Shamir secret sharing algorithm, and it does adds metadata to collect proof of work at every node, and it can be verified at the end to see if it matches what you were expecting. So there are three large sets of information. One is per node scope data. This involves the trace related information and timestamps that you can collect on each transit node that a packet traversed. Then there is only a set of nodes. For example, if you have checkpoints in the network and you want to make sure that the packet went through all the checkpoints it was intended to go through, so only a subset of your network would really work on that metadata and update the metadata. So that's the set of nodes class of data that you could have. Then there is edge-to-edge scope. You could sequence number the packet at the edge, and then you could only look at that sequence number at the end of the journey. Then you can determine packet loss, reordering, stuff like that. There is also some work going on in the IoT area to use this sequence or edge-to-edge scope data for timestamping and have some kind of a deadline-based routing where you can look at the timestamp and decide to prioritize that packet data. So that work is going on in the IETF 6 slow work group. Based on this data, we are in the IPPM group. We have an active work group draft for IOM called IOM Data Draft. And here we are defining these three sets of information as three different option types. This is the first one, which is the trace option. Again, in this there are two variants. One is software friendly, one is hardware friendly variant for collecting the trace data. Software is typically good at doing array kind of processing. So we have what we call a pre-allocated trace option, where the entire data required for collecting the information is inserted one time, and all the transit nodes will go update their information in that array. The packet is not expanded at every hop. But that is not very friendly for hardware. Right? It is very hard to look up where to insert your data if there is a pre-allocated trace data array. Hardware implementations will do much better when the place where they need to insert this metadata is well defined. It knows the offset a priori. So we have something called an incremental trace option, where the trace data is the packet is continuously growing, but of course we have controls on to keep a check on how far it can grow, because you'll have PMTU and other issues. To avoid that, there is some field called max data length, which will prevent it from growing, having a check on how far it can grow. But the data is always inserted immediately following the header, and it keeps growing as the transit nodes insert the data. So there are two types of trace options. And within the trace option, we have the bit field you see here is to decide which kind of trace data you want to collect. You may not want to collect timestamps all the time. You don't want to, probably you just want to do the tracing. Or sometimes you just want to do timestamps to see where the delays are in the network. And sometimes you just want to create the geolocation of all the nodes that collected, that acted on the packet. So there are a bunch of data that can be controlled. There is no draft out yet which will define the model for controlling what kind of data, but we have an implementation in ODL to do this. This is the second option, which is pretty straightforward. It is not going to be acted on by every transit node, so you need for the algorithm that we have defined, we need a random number, 64-bit random number, and a 64-bit proof of work, which is called the cumulative. So this is also part of the data draft. Then there is edge to edge. One of the edge to edge type could be the sequence number. Then there could be timestamp, which defines by when this packet needs to get out of your domain. We are defining one type of end-to-end data in the data draft that is currently in IPPM. There could be more that could come in. So there are INR registry defined for, is going to be defined for this type as well. Now, these are generic data types and generic options how you can carry it. But now, in a real packet, there will be a transport header encapsulation that is already there. You need to define how to insert this data into that NCAP. We are not touching IPv6 for now. It could be an IP in IP NCAP, or it could be a hub by hop extension header with options, with these options in that extension header that will be added. In the Singapore IETF, we are going to present transport for VXLAN, Geneva, and NSH. It could be TLVs if the encapsulation supports TLVs to carry it. If there is no support for TLVs in case of VXLAN GP, for example, it would become the next protocol header, and this data would be inserted in as next protocol header. Again, while we were doing reference implementation, and especially the chip vendors, Marvell, Mellanox, Barefoot guys had concerns about TLV in TLV approach, which is not very friendly for hardware to implement at all. So we have expanded, we are consciously trying to avoid nested TLVs to implement these options. So we are not defining a big container and putting all this as TLVs inside, but having a more flatter structure for this TLVs from the experience we had with implementing it in hardware. So we have a reference implementation that a bunch of us mostly from Cisco did in FD.io in the vector packet processing software data plane. For controlling for service chain verification for the proof of transit, we need to do a bunch of pre-created keys and stuff, which and then has to be provisioned on the switches. That is done in the open daylight, and that is also available in open daylight as well as in IOM public GitHub repository. Then there are chipset vendors who have implemented IOM. There are a bunch of them who are also co-authoring this work in IETF. We have a lot of use cases demonstrated with the reference implementation that is available in those links. That material should be available after this. So in IETF, other than publishing those drafts and getting them, get them adopted in various places, we also did demonstrations of this work in bits and bytes in the previous IETFs. So mostly at the Comcast table, and this is the ecosystem we built to build those use case demos, which you'll see in the next slide. So we have a VPP-based implementation for the data plane, which is mostly we have used VXLAN GP and IPv6 implementation. Then we have ODL to do the configuration and stuff. Then we do IPv6 export. This is not standardized, so we do some kind of raw export of this data that is collected, because this will be really in actual deployments, there will be a large scale and large amount of data that will be generated. So we don't want to really do a lot of processing on the routers, but do some form of raw export of this data that is collected. And we have, for the demonstration purposes, we have used most of the open source tools to collect this data and then put it on a message bus and then analyze it, make it give some visual idea about what happened based on the data collected. And also create a feedback loop to detect anomalies and then feed it back into the network to change your path or do various things. Other than the motivation use cases that we saw in the motivation, okay. These were the demos that came out of discussions at IETF, and we went back, implemented, and showcased it in the bits and bytes in the subsequent IETFs. This one is especially interesting for the service provider use case for video delivery. It's called as M-Anycast. Instead of delivering Anycast or deploying Anycast or multicast in your network, what we could do is deploy microservices, divide your video into small chunks, deploy it as make it available via microservices in the cloud, and continuously see which microservice is up before the video gets delivered, before you select which connection for video streaming is made active. And for that, we used In-situ OAM to detect what is the current condition if there are multiple services serving the same video clip. So this demo is again available in the video channel, in the IOM YouTube video channel. The next was, it's not really in-band OAM in the traditional, in the sense that we were defining it, the second one, the probing thing. This is what, this is actually creating a lot of probes. And in the probes, we insert this data so that we get correlated information out of, this is kind of a spider, a crawling, this is mostly came from the Facebook use case where they wanted to continuously crawl their ECMP links in their data center and detect, proactively detect any issues that can, that might occur in the, before the data traffic hits bad links or bad nodes in the network. The next is mostly enterprise-related use case, the VXLAN GPE one, where you want to continuously get a dashboard of how your links are behaving, and then you could take action on that. So this was these were the three things which we have showcased at Bits and Bytes. Now, what are we going to do in IETF Singapore? Is we have a project defined for hackathon. We are going to do an implementation interop between VPP and P4 based implementation. Barefoot guys have done that implementation, and we from Cisco, FireEye all, are actively implementing and testing it out on Simple Switch, which is a P4 based switch, and VPP interoperability. So that is that will be in the next, the first 2 days of IETF. Next we have slots for SFC, Lisp, and NVMO3 to present the transport drafts for in-band OAM, and the data draft that has been updated based on the feedback that we received from IPPM group will be discussed in the IPPM work group. So anybody interested in joining us at the hackathon, you're welcome. We can help you, or even if you want to get an experience with the software data plane VPP, which is a very interesting reference implementation platform that you could use, you can join us at the hackathon table. So that's pretty much I had. Thank you.
My question was like this in-band OAM. So when we are putting the metadata, it is like, are we putting for all packets, or can we select like in a sampling case, 1 in 1,000 or something like that?
You could do that. You could do both. You could enable it if you have resources, and if your hardware supports line speed processing of this metadata, you could do that for all the packets. That was the idea which started with. But that might not always be possible. So instead of sampling, you might even do it for certain flows. That might give a complete picture of if it is for troubleshooting, you could do it for the flows that you are troubleshooting. So you would want to control for what flows, what packets you would want to insert this. But sampling might not give you a really good picture.
Like flow base, I can select.
Is there any plan to support for IPv4 packets?
IPv4 with some overlay like GRE, there is support, or we should do an IP in IP, but we are not right now defining IP options for this. You would have seen the IPv6 extension header related discussions if you are following Sixman. It is going to be hard to define extension header and options to do something like this. There is a lot of resistance to do that. While the hardware and software are becoming more capable to do that, people, especially with operational experience, are resistant to moving to something like this at the moment. So IPv4, we are not thinking of defining it in the IP options.
So, sorry, Shweta, the last question. So on the Facebook case, can you explain a little bit what sort of data was running through? And
So in the Facebook case, what we are doing is you define a range of UDP ports and do the UDP probing between rack and your spine rack and top of the rack switches. You have servers in the farm which are continuously sending these probes to other servers, and you do a sweep of all the ports that would hit all the multiple ECMP paths. But you insert the in-band OAM data so that at each stage of your processing, you get timestamps, you get a snapshot of that node snapshot collected in the packet, and then you extract that information and keep track of it and do analysis of what's going on.
Thanks, Shweta.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shweta, for a great discussion.